Are you struggling to come up with original content week in and week out? Start a podcast. Interview your ideal clients, let them talk about what they care about most, and never run out of content ideas again. Learn more at sweetfishmedia.com.
You're listening to B2B Growth, a daily podcast for B2B leaders. We've interviewed names you've probably heard before, like Gary Vaynerchuk and Simon Sinek, but you've probably never heard from the majority of our guests. That's because the bulk of our interviews aren't with professional speakers and authors. Most of our guests are in the trenches leading sales and marketing teams. They're implementing strategy. They're experimenting with tactics. They're building the fastest growing B2B companies in the world. My name is James Carberry. I'm the founder of Sweetfish Media, a podcast agency for B2B brands, and I'm also one of the co-hosts of this show. When we're not interviewing sales and marketing leaders, you'll hear stories from behind the scenes of our own business. We'll share the ups and downs of our journey as we attempt to take over the world. Just kidding. Well, maybe. Let's get into the show.
Hello, and welcome to the B2B Growth Show Monthly Book Talk. I'm Douglas Burdett, host of the Marketing Book Podcast, where each week I publish an interview with the author of a new marketing or sales book to help my listeners succeed in the quickly changing world of marketing and sales. Joining me is my friend James Muir, author of The Perfect Close, The Secret to Closing Sales, the best-selling practices and techniques for closing the deal. I read every book featured on the Marketing Book Podcast, but James reads even more books than I do, and he listens to every episode of the Marketing Book Podcast, so I'm delighted that he can join me. In this monthly episode of the B2B Growth Show, we briefly recap some of the key ideas from the marketing and sales books that were recently featured on the Marketing Book Podcast. James, welcome back to the B2B Growth Show Book Talk.
Thank you, Douglas. In this episode, we're going to talk about five recent books featured on the Marketing Book Podcast, which are The Science of Customer Connections, Manage Your Message to Grow Your Business by Jim Carr, The Innovation Mandate, The Growth Secrets of the Best Organizations in the World by Nicholas Webb, Indistractable, How to Control Your Attention and Choose Your Life by Nir Eyal, Marketing to the Entitled Customer, How to Turn Unreasonable Expectations into Lasting Relationships by Nick Wirth, Dave Frankland, and Josh Burnoff. And finally, The Invisible Brand, Marketing in the Age of Automation, Big Data, and Machine Learning by William Emmerman. So on to the books. First up, we've got The Science of Customer Connections, Manage Your Message to Grow Your Business by Jim Carr. Now, this book is Management Meets Messaging. So tell us a little bit about The Science of Customer Connections.
Yes, it's an interesting idea because, as you may have heard, most word-of-mouth marketing, believe it or not, is offline. It's not online. And the books I've read about word-of-mouth marketing all confirm that. And there are actually some things that companies can do to try and stimulate, encourage, and manage the offline messages of their employees. And so the book talks about how to frame the message about what your company does and, you know, what the problems you solve rather than talking about, I mean, it's kind of the things you see in a lot of sales books where you talk about the pain points, talk about the problems rather than the, you know, the specific technology that you all have. And then it also talks about why companies are so freaked out by any kind of communications and why they shouldn't be, but also how to avoid messaging problems. And as you mentioned, it does have a fair amount about management. It's required to do this sort of thing, but it can be done.
Yeah, there's three parts of the book, right? There's the message, the messengers, and the management habits. And this is the first book I've ever read that actually, you know, sort of looked at the whole messaging problem challenge from a management perspective. So I thought it was unique in that regard.
Yeah, there are so many things in marketing now that really require much more of a engineered approach from the whole company, you know, like customer experience and your culture and, you know, that sort of thing, where this is the same sort of thing where you will want to, it's not going to be successful if you don't have management buy-in and encouragement for doing this, and but it can be done.
Agreed. And I thought it was interesting. He sort of explodes that myth that is so prominent in sales that extroverts are the best sales professionals in there when he's talking about the messengers. It turns out that ambiverts rule, right? Which
right.
is something Daniel Pink mentioned in his book as well.
Yeah, absolutely. But it was interesting. And I just think that companies can wait for this to happen to them badly, or they can start to be more proactive about what is the message that your company is telling and encouraging. And again, it can be done, and it can be done successfully. And it's not like you're trying to manipulate employees. You're just sharing throughout the organization more effective ways to help people better understand what your company does.
Yep, agreed. And unique in that regard, I thought. So very good read for managers who want to drive better messaging and conversations inside their organization. What was your biggest takeaway, you think, from this one?
That you can actually manage your company's offline messages more effectively than most companies thought they could.
Gotcha. All right. Well, next up, we've got The Innovation Mandate, The Growth Secrets of the Best Organizations in the World by Nicholas Webb. And it's been said that the only long-term sustainable business growth strategy is innovation. And this might be my favorite book this month. So tell us a little bit about The Innovation Mandate.
This is a terrific book. And as you know, I only have terrific books on the show. But Nicholas Webb, first I should say, he was on the show a couple of years ago for his book, What Customers Crave, which is just a brilliant book about customer experience. And so this book is about innovation. And he talks about why companies need to innovate more now than even in the past, because the rate of change is so quick. If you look at companies that are on the S&P 500, they used to be there 100 years or 50 years. In a couple years, it's estimated that most companies are going to go on and off the S&P 500 in less than 10 years. So there's so much change going on, and the rate of it is increasing, and the technology is increasing it. So it's forcing companies, or I should say another way, the most successful companies are those that are continuously innovating. And one of the things, he dispels a lot of myths about innovation. And one of the things that companies should understand is that it's not necessarily about a great new product. Innovation, and also innovation should not come from your R&D department. In other words, you could have an R&D department, but don't say that they're the ones in charge of innovation. If you are, like so many of these books in marketing and sales, if you're able to focus and observe your customers and start to find out where the friction is in their lives, you are going to be able to start developing ideas that will make their life and certainly their experience with you more effective. So Uber or Lyft, they're not owning cars, and they didn't develop some new product, but what they did is they simply found friction in a prospective customer's life. And so when a company wants to be innovative, of course, just like the last book we were talking about, if there's not commitment from the management, it fails. Mm-hmm. He pretty much guarantees it's going to fail because everyone starts to realize that it's flavor of the month. Oh, we're going to be innovative. We're going to be innovative. But what's interesting is that his book walks you through how to set up an innovation system where you are getting information from your vendors, from your customers, from your employees, and that's where some of the greatest innovation ideas come from.
Yeah, not only does it show you that it's possible, but it provides a step-by-step system for establishing innovation and a whole pipeline in your organization. And I thought that was very unique. Of all the books I've read of innovation, this was easily the most practical and applicable book.
Yeah, you know, let me add to that. The reason I so much wanted to have this on here is because I'm such a fan of Nick Webb, but also a few months ago, I heard from a marketing book podcast listener who had taken a new marketing job, and she had previously been in sales earlier in her career, but this company, this big company, they were saying, we've got to be more innovative. We've got to be more innovative. And I could just envision the executive slamming their hands on the conference room table saying, go be innovative. It's like a CEO looking at the marketing people saying, go market, go do marketing. And so they even said to her, you know, you're going to have to go and we need you to lead an innovation workshop. And for all I know, that management's probably thinking innovation means some sort of clever new marketing trick. So I said, oh, you've got to read this book. And then as well as another book that was on the show not too long ago called Nincompoopery, Why Your Customers Hate You and How to Fix It. Because John Brandt talks quite a bit about innovation. And she got them both. And she said, oh, yes, this is exactly what I need. And it's a typical example of where a marketer is having to be much more of a leader in their organization. They're having to educate about setting this in place. So I'm sure by now there's a whole box of his books that she shared with her management. So yeah, terrific, terrific book.
Yeah, I really love how practical this book is. It's just oozing with real-world examples. And with a theme like innovation, it would have been really easy to make it look ethereal or like fairy dust or, you know, he calls it a unicorn in the book. But this book is actually the opposite of that. And that's really what I liked so much about this book is it was very practical and hard-hitting. So your favorite part?
Oh, gosh, you always ask me that. And I'm worried I'm going to hurt the author's feelings. I think my favorite part is how he bursts all these myths of innovation. So many companies think that if you have to have innovation, it's from a new product, which is pretty rare, actually. There's other ways to innovate. And frankly, sometimes a new product your customer doesn't care about so much as innovating the way you deliver it or you provide your service.
Yeah, there's tons of opportunities for innovation.
Yeah.
Right. And that's kind of the connection between it and nincompoopery, right? Is the basic premise is that innovation in all its different forms needs to be a normal part of business, just like supply chain, just like marketing campaign. Innovation is not this impenetrable black box. Rather, it should be woven into the very fabric of your daily operations throughout the business.
Companies should have a sales process, a documented sales process. I know some, you know, many don't. But if you have that, there's all the studies that show that if you have that, you can then improve upon it and iterate and all that and measure it. Exact same thing with innovation. It's as simple and practical as that, but you have to know what you're doing and you have to read his book.
Yeah. I think if a sand and gravel company can boost its profitability using innovation, then any company can do that.
Yes. That was such a great example because we were joking about how, oh, we're only talking about Amazon or Lyft or Uber, or, you know, all those techie companies that are required by podcast law to mention. And I'm kidding. But he said, you know, that was my favorite example in the book was this sand and gravel company. They started innovating and of course it boosted their profitability and they got faster sales, but it was innovating. You're not going to innovate sand and gravel. I'm sorry to tell you, but when you can be a massively innovative company and you're selling sand and gravel, and aggregates for all those kinds of things like building roads, anybody can do it.
Yep. Amen. All right. Next up, we've got Indistractable, How to Control Your Attention and Choose Your Life by Nir Eyal. This book crosses the threshold of marketing into kind of a personal achievement area. So, you know, tell us a little bit about Indistractable.
Well, first I should say that Nir Eyal was on the show several years ago to talk about his phenomenal bestseller first book called Hooked.
Yeah.
And that book is now on the bookshelf of every office in Silicon Valley and every SaaS company. But that book talked about how companies build addictive products. So as he said, you know, Facebook didn't need to read the book to know how to do it. But when I read the book, I thought, holy cow, I can't believe that. That book is what prompted me to remove social media from my phone because I saw how it was working on my brain and all that sort of thing. So that was a great book. It freaked me out a little bit. And then this book, Indistractable, he explains brilliantly that in the 21st century, because of the explosion of information and technology that makes it so accessible, the superpower of the 21st century will be your ability to keep from being distracted. And he explains that this isn't new. You know, Tantalus, the Greek god, from which we get the word tantalizing, even then they were talking about distractions. You know, there's traction and then there's distraction. Think of it on two things on a continuum. And so basically he explains the science behind why we become distracted. And if you become distracted, there's nothing wrong with you. And there are certain things that you can do to keep from being distracted. And in the book, he talks about, first the part of the book, he explains why you become distracted, which was just a great reminder. And then he talks about a lot of very practical ways of keeping from being distracted, whether you're working in an open office environment, whether you're being asked for too many meetings, whether you are even, like if you have Facebook on your computer, on your desk, your desktop, let's say, because I don't even have it on my phone anymore. And there's even a Chrome plugin where it doesn't show the feed to you, but you can still see if someone's leaving you a message.
Right. Newsfeed Eradicator.
Yes, Newsfeed Eradicator, which is free and it's just phenomenal. And I'd been using it for years. And I think, because I know you're going to ask this, one of the biggest takeaways I had was this concept that your attention is sort of like money you're putting on a counter. And you're allowing people to come in and take the money off the counter. So in other words, if you are easily distracted, you are probably enabling it quite a bit. And after reading both his books, I am reminded of this notion of no Facebook, no Twitter. I'm not allowing you to take control. I'm going to be in control. Same like with email. I don't even have email on my phone. It's like the idea of, okay, you check your email twice a day. And actually, in the book, he talks about how you should never answer an email right away because you're training the recipient to expect you to always be there. It's full of things like that. And he said the genesis of the book was when he was with his daughter one day, a little girl, and he was on his phone and she was trying to talk to him and they were supposed to be playing, and it just suddenly dawned on him that he wasn't present, and it really, you know, really bothered him. And he started to go into why he was becoming distracted. And I guess he, like so many of us, we think that the things that are distracting us, they're not worthy of distracting us.
Right. You know, this book actually adds a couple of really important psychology contributions that I haven't read anywhere else. One of them was that time management is really pain management.
Yes.
Right?
And we have to be able to manage that.
Manage the pain and discomfort that's keeping us from doing what we really care about, right? And so the root of motivation is actually to move away from discomfort. So to me, that was a very, very insightful. And you start to look at why you're being distracted and what you're really trying, what you're avoiding by being distracted. And that really causes you to look, of course, back at yourself. The other interesting thing that he added is that for years, we've been taught that willpower is a finite resource, right? And that it runs out, and that you have more willpower in the morning. And then as the day goes on, it sort of trickles out and runs out of gas. And he says, well, that is true if you think it is.
Yes.
Wasn't that interesting?
Yes.
They tested it. And if people thought that they run out of willpower, well, then they do. But if they don't, they don't. And so that it's not just a fact that your willpower runs out. It only runs out if you think it does.
Right. You may be getting more tired during the day, but don't confuse that with your willpower.
Yeah, I really love the psychology and all the steps he laid out. A very practical book to help improve relationships with family and friends. And to me, that's the reason that you're trying to keep yourself from getting distracted, which I think you know he used in his example with his daughter, right? She, what superpower would you want? And he doesn't know, right? Because he was looking at his phone when she answered that.
That's right. That's what it was. Yes. I can't remember any of this without you on the call, James.
Well, you pick the books and I read them. Yes.
All right. Yes.
Next, we have Marketing to the Entitled Consumer, How to Turn Unreasonable Expectations into Lasting Relationships by Nick Wirth, Dave Franklin, and Josh Bernoff. And when I first saw this title, I thought it was going to be all about millennials. But newsflash, we are all entitled consumers. So tell us a little bit about Marketing to the Entitled Consumer.
So yes, right away, the title screams whiny millennials, which everyone loves to beat up. Well, millennials are not whiny. I think people are just whiny regardless of their age. So they said the genesis. Now I should say Dave Franklin used to work at Forrester in their customer experience group. I think he may have started it. And so they were at a dinner and they'd been doing some research for their company. And one of the people at the dinner was complaining about how when you are using a ride-sharing app like Lyft or Uber, that where it shows the car driving, it's not always exactly where it is. It might be maybe a half block behind or something like this. And this guy was complaining about it. And that's when Dave and some of the others said, listen to us. What's the matter with us? He said, if you'd come to us 5 or 10 years before those things, those ride-sharing apps came out and said, look, there's this new thing you're going to put on your smartphone and you can call it and you're going to know how much it's going to cost, you know who the driver's going to be, you're going to know pretty much exactly when they're going to get there, and you don't have to exchange money, it's going to be charged to your credit card, on and on, all the great things, and you're going to be able to rate the driver. Everyone would have said, I'll take it. But if they said, okay, but the little icon is not always going to be exactly where it shows your car is, everyone would say, not a problem, I'll take it. So,
exactly.
So he talks about how customers are feeling entitled, but not exactly in the way you think. So customers now have so much more control and so much more power. But One of the concepts they talk about in the book is with the entitled consumer, which is where it may be misunderstood, is that if a customer gives you some information, some data about them, use that data to communicate with them more effectively. For instance, if you've just bought something for a company, don't start asking them to buy the exact same thing from you every day. Or take what you know about this customer and make yourself more useful. That's what they mean by entitled. You give them information and then you use that information to give them a better experience. It's not hard. The technology's there, but you've got to stop being so damn sloppy. And the foreword to the book was written by NFL Hall of Famer Steve Young, who played most of his career with the San Francisco 49ers, and he was an MVP in the Super Bowl and on and on and on. And he said, you know, I had 107 interceptions when I played professional football. And whenever I would throw one of these interceptions, I would have some excuse, like the sun was in my eyes, or there was always an excuse. And the other guys on the team didn't really want to hear about it. And the coach didn't want to hear about it. So what he did was he said, I'm just going to own it. And I'm going to try to figure out how to throw fewer interceptions. So he's talking about how companies and marketers are throwing lots of interceptions and they need to own up and stop trying to throw these stupid interceptions. Stop being so stupid. Stop appearing like an ignorant company that knows nothing about your customers.
Yeah, besides, customers don't care about your
interceptions. No, and neither does the coach care about the interceptions. So the root or the linchpin of the whole book is sort of like with the innovation mandate. You have to have customer-focused marketing. The more that your company can focus around the consumer or the customer, the more effective everything else is going to be. But most companies are focused around themselves and how they want to be organized. Anyway, they talk about how...
They call it consumer-first
marketing. Yes, consumer-first marketing. Thank you. And how you need to be more adaptive. And, you know, they talk about how companies don't have to do this, but in the future, there's going to be a wide gulf. There's not going to be an even continuum. You're going to have companies that understand this and get it, and then you're going to have all the laggards. There's not going to be any middle ground there.
And so that kind of ties into their whole concept of transference of entitlement. Do you remember this? So basically, we take our expectation, whatever our expectation is of our best experience somewhere, and then we transfer that onto another situation. So we're like, well, geez, if Disney can do it this way, how come you can't do it this way? Or if Amazon can do it this way, how come you can't do it this way?
Right, right. And that's where he says there's a folly where a company will say, well, we're the best in our category. Absolutely wrong thing to say. First, for two reasons. One, your competitors might suck. I mean, you might be the best of a crappy industry. Home remodeling comes to mind as my colleague is suffering through that right now. He's sitting there now. But also, it doesn't matter because if they see that some other company can do this, then you should do it. Just like, you know, Amazon, why am I... this is no kidding, James Muir. I ordered a book the other day. It was actually on Amazon and some buyer, and they said, okay, it'll be there next month. I said, what? But it wasn't Amazon selling it. It was some other third-party seller. I mean, I canceled it immediately and said, I can't wait that long. And there were others that you could get pretty quickly. But it was like a month? No, I do actually need to get it in a couple days because I want to get it read before this book club that I'm going to go meet with. So anyway, it's this transference, I'm glad you mentioned that, is such a great example.
Yeah, I think listeners should know that there's actually a ton of science in this book. It's a very good book. And they make some distinctions at the very beginning between hard entitlement, which is, you know, people making demands. They want control. If you don't give me what I want, I'm going to punish you, right? That's hard entitlement. And then there's soft entitlement, which is more what you were talking about. People are willing to share their data to get better service, but what they're expecting is that I'll help you and give you some of my data if you, you know, help me get what I want.
Yeah, become more relevant to me because I've shared this data with you.
Yeah, exactly right. So I really like the huge amount of data in here. And these guys do a really excellent job of decoding, you know, clients we all talk about after they leave, they were unhappy and unreasonable. And there's some very interesting implications, I think, here on this book for the healthcare space, which I spent a lot of time in, right? Everyone in healthcare accepts that patient centricity is the key to solving the healthcare crisis. But I can tell you that we got a long, long way to go before we're hitting, you know, yeah, patient centricity. Just go to visit the doctor sometime and you'll see what I'm talking about. I think every physician and administrator should read this book because it would give them a very eye-opening perspective on what it really means to be patient-centered or customer-centered.
Yeah, this book was, like so many of them, just beautifully written and very well explained. You know, my hat's off to these guys on this book. I think it's a book that's going to be around for a while too. That's a very important book to read for marketers. It's also super relevant to sales because these, you know, the whole idea of a CRM, you know, stop having four people trying to call me for the same thing. And why don't you know what we talked about last time to, you know, move me further along in the sales process?
I know. It is so bad. And all you got to do is look at your email box to see that everybody in the world is ignoring that principle. Even people that claim that they're outbound companies that should know better. They're still doing it. So it's amazing. All right. Last up, we've got The Invisible Brand, Marketing in the Age of Automation, Big Data, and Machine Learning by William Ammerman. This book is about AI and marketing, and boy, is it an eye-opener. Give us the lowdown on The Invisible Brand.
Sure. The idea for the book title was very interesting to me. So anyone that's ever heard of Adam Smith, he wrote? Wealth of Nations?
The Invisible Hand.
Well, the Wealth of Nations is like 1776. And it's about economics. It's, the concept in that was, and he's considered like the father of modern economics, but this idea of the invisible hand of economics, where there's this underlying force that searches for competitive advantage and offering value. And it's why, not to get political, but it's why a more of a capitalist approach works better than a command and control economy, because the invisible hand of economics is able to be much more efficient and find needs and fill those needs more efficiently. I know all the economists listening to this are saying, oh, this guy doesn't know what he's talking about, but I did my best. Okay, so The Invisible Brand is a very similar thing, where this automation and this machine learning, it's getting things to become more efficient, it's always learning, and it's operating in the background all the time. And so he talks about how there's lots of software out there that is just getting smarter and smarter and smarter, and it relates to ad buying, and as it collects more data, or like, you know, you hear about the Internet of Things, where every device now can be connected. Well, you just keep getting more and more of that that information. So he does a little bit about the history of how, like, ad buying has become increasingly programmatic. And he talks about how social media uses a lot of these very same things. This wasn't just about marketing. And what was interesting is he does a brilliant job of explaining how we are, because of all this machine learning and AI and so forth, we are going increasingly into our own bubbles in terms of the information we're getting. And even the news that we're offered up, it's based on our reactions in the past. So he gave an example of how, you know, everyone's news feed is different on Facebook or LinkedIn or whatever. And you have to be very careful about where you get your information now, because it's serving you only what it thinks that you want to have. So right. that was kind of freaking me out. And then he talks about, you know, the things that the governments can be doing. And even, look at the worst example in China, where they're going to debut soon a scoring system for every citizen based on what they're observing about your behaviors and in all aspects of life. Well, that's using all of that sort of stuff. And so, and on and on. So This isn't science fiction either.
No, and as you read this whole thing, you just start to realize how much potential for good there is, but also how much potential there is for bad there. And of course, the scary thing is it's already here, right? And that, I think that's one of the things that makes the whole thing so interesting. So what did you think about the potential abuses in Google Noia, his thoughts in there?
It freaked me out. You know, I'm using DuckDuckGo more. I don't know. It pushed me in a few directions I hadn't seen before. And I know that in Europe, there's much more sensitivity to your own personal data and that sort of thing. I think I understand why that's such a concern. You know, what I mean by that is everyone's concerned about it, but I believe in Europe, like with GDPR, you're in Europe, there's some, I think, pending legislation, or maybe it's an EU thing where they want people to have the right to remove their digital past or something like that. Again, I'm irritating the economists as well as the legislators now, but I better understood why that is, because I saw the potential for so much evil with all of this sort of thing. And of course, there are wonderful things. You can have a much better experience with a company and that type of thing. But I hear so much about artificial intelligence and big data and machine learning. And I think a lot of people think, oh yeah, that's future. That's 2001, A Space Odyssey. You know, that's way out there. But as we, you know, as you mentioned, as we said in the interview, it's
right
here.
Now.
It's already here. And it probably made me drive home thinking different things, because I was just so much more familiar with it. And I think that, you know, if there's one book to read, this would be a great one for marketers to understand the role it's playing. I don't think marketers should be afraid of it. It will replace some jobs, but there's even more jobs that need to come in. But you know what else was interesting in the book? He talked about how in the past marketers, and we still do, we know how to not game the search engine algorithms. You can't really do that anymore.
Not anymore.
Fortunately.
Yeah.
And he talks about how you need to be able to game or have a deep, deep understanding in how the artificial intelligence algorithms are working in order to get your product found.
Yeah, you might not get fun up, but he spends quite a little time, and I think it's very valuable, his contribution on voice search here. I've not read anywhere else what he's got in the first few chapters of the book about the importance of voice search and how that relates to us as marketers.
Yes.
Right? And some folks might be thinking, hey, I'm not going to mess with that, but the truth is, it's upon you. Yeah, and that's if people are buying that way, then we have to engage in that technology. And that's why he's encouraging us to understand the algorithms, because if you don't feed the algorithms what they want, you won't get found.
Yeah, it's as simple as that. And I think at the end of the interview, I said, what's something somebody could do today, you know, based on an idea in your book? He said, see if you can find your company or buy your product by using voice search. Do it right now. And, you know, I had been, Google had sent me whatever their smart speaker is called. I Google at Home, I think. And so I played with it here in the office, and I couldn't seem to get it set up correctly. But, you know, I'm the guy that on a VCR, it always blinked 12. So, and for the younger listeners, a VCR was a thing where you would put a tape cartridge in and you could watch a movie. Maybe you've heard of DVDs. But anyway, then I brought it home, and my son, who has a computer science degree, he was able to get it set up. And we just used it like to say, what time is it? Or what's the weather? I went home and disconnected that thing. I don't want anyone listening to anything I'm doing at home. I don't know. Maybe it's just me. But he talked in the book about how a couple was talking about some renovation they were doing in their home or something. I mean, something insignificant. Uh-huh. And that smart speaker then emailed a transcript of their conversation to their entire contact list.
Boom. Yeah. And we had similar experiences here at our house where it suddenly thinks we said something and it spits out a bunch of stuff.
Yes.
So it's listening all the time.
And what I had to laugh, though, at the end of the interview, I said, how best can listeners learn more about you and your book? He said, well, here's what they should do. They should say, Alexa, buy William Ammerman's book, The Invisible Brand. Or whatever your command is. And I just thought, oh, well played, good sir. Well played.
How funny. Yeah, I love this book. William Emmerman brings sense to the whole AI revolution that's taking place right now. He writes in a way that's easy to understand, it's easy to digest. The processes and the scenarios are all explained in his book. And he does something that I haven't seen. I've read a few AI books, and he does something I haven't seen in any other AI books, and that is he takes the time to assess the impact to people as an actual consideration. And I think that's a value contribution that nobody else has done yet. So undoubtedly a fascinating, sobering, and very timely insight into the rapidly changing world of marketing and AI.
Yeah, and let me just add to that. I have gotten a number of books about AI that come in here, and I've gone through them, and I know it's just me, and I'm probably wrong, but there are a number of authors that are trying to show how smart they are. Well, I think William Emmerman is so smart that he didn't feel the need to do that. Instead, he was explaining something, just like Rand Fishkin explains search engine optimization. You know, if you're smart enough and you know the subject, you can explain it in a way that a knuckleheaded podcaster like myself can understand
it. And that's us.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, good.
All right. Well, this month's books touched, you know, as much on personal achievement and business growth as they did marketing. So tell us a little bit about the books that are coming up on the Marketing Book Podcast.
Okay. Well, next month, there's only four. Okay. So we're back to four. The first one is Hello, My Name is Awesome. How to Create Brand Names That Stick by Alexandra Watkins. It's the second edition of that excellent, absolutely creative, hilarious book. The next one is Strategy Man versus the Anti-Strategy Squad, Using Strategic Thinking to Defeat Bad Strategy and Save Your Plan by Rich Horwath. It is a graphic novel. The whole thing, 166 pages of cartoons. It is absolutely brilliant. It must have cost a fortune to produce. It was really well done. And we're going to talk about that next time. The next one is Get the Meeting, an Illustrative Contact Marketing Playbook by Stu Hynek, who's a friend of you and me. And it's a follow-up to his first book, which was a hands-down bestseller called How to Get a Meeting with Anyone. Brilliant book about how to break through to get a meeting with the person that can change everything for your business, your career, or whatever. It's this one's more tactical and has lots of case studies. And the last one, which will be episode 250, is Mean People Suck, How Empathy Leads to Bigger Profits and a Better Life by Michael Brenner. And it's the first book I've had on about empathy, which, as you probably already know, I think is the most important word in marketing and sales. And that's it for this month's B2B Growth Show Book Talk. To learn more about the Marketing Book Podcast, visit marketingbookpodcast.com. And to learn more about James and his excellent book, The Perfect Close, visit puremuir.com. That's spelled puremuir.com. And if either of us can recommend a specific sales or marketing book or other resource for whatever situation you find yourself in, feel free to connect with us on LinkedIn where we can chat, and we'll do our best to get you pointed in the right direction and maybe even save you some time. And remember, keep learning, because these days the big learners are the big earners.
If you're a regular listener of B2B Growth, odds are you might enjoy Sales Success Stories with Scott Ingram as well. Well, this year, thanks to a partnership with Outreach and Sales Hacker, our friend Scott Ingram is making the live stream of his Sales Success Summit available for free. The event is on October 14th and 15th, featuring 13 presentations and 5 panels, all presented by top-performing B2B sales professionals. You can check it out and register at top1.fm/live. That's top1.fm/live.